Before we begin, I would like to first of all offer my sincere condolences to the Quinlan family on the recent passing of Marcella Quinlan. For those of you who don't know, Marcella Quinlan, I guess, was the matriarch of the Quinlan family. She was 96, I believe, at the time of her passing, and the family are gathering today, actually, in Bedford for the wake of the funeral is tomorrow. Is that correct? So our thoughts and prayers are with the Quinlan family right now. Okay, today we'll be inducting three new and very deserving Newfoundland and Labrador members into the Atlantic Canada Marine Industries Hall of Fame. The individuals were nominated by their peers and chosen by a fishing industry selection committee. All three are very worthy inductees who have had major impacts in the marine industries field in Atlantic Canada and even more specifically Newfoundland and Labrador. First, a little bit of background on the Hall of Fame itself. The Atlantic Canada Marine Industries Hall of Fame was developed by the Navigator magazine in partnership with Master Promotions that puts off this fine show here in 2 years. The Hall pays tribute to those who have made or are making valuable contributions in any marine industry in Atlantic Canada. So there are three categories that will be awarding, making presentations into the Hall of Fame today. First category is the Mariner category, which recognizes individuals who have made a significant contribution at sea in any marine field. This could include anyone from a captain or a crew member on anything from fishing boat to cargo ships to oil tankers to coast guards and everything else in between. The second category is the processor category, which recognizes individuals involved in the business of processing, developing marine products from fish and seafood to oil and gas, including everyone from frontline workers right up to company executives and owners. And the third and final category is the builder category, which recognizes those individuals who have made significant contributions to any of Atlantic Canada's marine industries without having necessarily participated in them, including, but not limited to, industry advocates, organizers, service providers, marine builders, business people, government, and yes, even media people, those media folks that are here. The Hall is a lasting tribute. Tribute by way of a website and the public display that you can see here. This display travels to each show, each of the three marine shows here in St. John's, Yarmouth, Nova Scotia, and Moncton, New Brunswick. And the Hall is a lasting tribute to those who have made or are making valuable contributions in any marine industry in Atlantic Canada. But before we get into the actual ceremony, I would like to welcome some special guests that have joined us this afternoon. Our first guest needs no introduction in this neck of the woods, the Honourable Judy Foote. Judy Foote was first elected federally as the Member of Parliament for Random Muir and St. George's in 2008 and re-elected in 2011. Following the redistribution of federal boundaries, Ms. Foote was elected as a Member of Parliament for the new riding of Bonavista, Bjorn, Trinity. It's a big, riding. In October 2015, and she accrued 82% of the vote, highest percentage of any vote of any candidate in all of Canada, so it's quite impressive. Ms. Foote was named to Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's cabinet and sworn in as Minister of Public Services and Procurement. The department is the government's principal banker, accountant, central purchasing agent, linguistic authority, and real property manager. Now that's even hard to say, let alone actually have those responsibilities, so it's an important job to say the least. In the previous parliamentary sessions, Ms. Foote served as the Liberal Whip and Deputy House Leader of the Liberal Official Opposition. Prior to her work at the federal level, Ms. Foote was the member of the House of Assembly of Newfoundland and Labrador for the District of Grand Bank. She held positions of Minister of Development and Rural Renewal, Minister of Industry, Trade and Technology, Minister of Education, Minister of Industry, Trade and Rural Development. Before entering politics in 1996, Ms. Foote worked with Premier Clyde Wells as Director of Communications and as a Director of University Relations with Memorial University of Newfoundland. Ms. Foote holds a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Education from Memorial University and an Honors Diploma in Radio and Television Broadcast Arts from Lambton College. Ms. Foote and her husband Howard have three children. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Judy Foote, Federal Minister of Public Services and Procurement.
Well, Well, thank you, Kerry, but I think at this point, everyone gathered here knows more about me than you really wanted to know. But it is good to be here, and I am delighted when Kerry asked if I would come and speak at this particular ceremony. I immediately said yes, because I thought it was really important to recognize not just the industry, but those who have contributed so significantly to it. And of course, being a girl from Grand Bank, historic fishing community, it was important that that I make the time to do this, and I'm delighted to be here. And at the same time, when I mentioned to Minister LeBlanc, the Minister of Fisheries and Oceans and Minister responsible for the Canadian Coast Guard, that I was going to be here, then he wanted to make sure that I brought his greetings as well. And we have a tremendous individual now serving as a Minister of Fisheries and Oceans, and his father served in that same capacity, the Honourable Romeo LeBlanc, several years ago. So as all of you know, Canadians rely on their coasts and waterways to earn a living, to import goods, and to export Canadian products, and we also appreciate them for cultural and recreational reasons. And we recognize, as a Government of Canada, how important the marine industry, the fishing industry, is to everyone from coast to coast to coast. I also want to take advantage, and I do this every time I speak, particularly in my home province, and that is to speak about opportunities that are available through the federal government. Because more often than not, when I do speak or I go up to local businesses, particularly small and medium enterprises, I find that they really do not have the wherewithal or the knowledge they need to be able to access government procurement, to no fault of their own, because from my take on this, that information has not been made readily available over the years. So I see my responsibility as doing just that. So the purchases made by my department add up to about $15 billion a year in contracts. Approximately 40% of this amount goes to Canadian small and medium enterprises. And I want these numbers to be higher, so I've said to the department that we need to go from 40 to 50%. All the procurement that we do needs to go to small and medium enterprises. And I think we all recognize that it is the small and medium enterprises that are the backbone of our economy. So we have a team in the department dedicated to promoting small and medium enterprises. It helps and encourages businesses to participate in government procurement process through outreach and information sessions such as seminars and webinars. We also have a significant online presence, and I want you to remember this, any of you who are interested. Our website, and it's our website because whenever I first was told about buy and sell, I said, that's a magazine in Newfoundland and Labrador. But actually, our website, it's buyandsell.gc.ca. And that website allows buyers and suppliers to access procurement and information and to use it to meet their needs. It also has an event calendar where you can find out about webinars and seminars that are taking place in Newfoundland and Labrador. So if you don't remember anything else about what I say today, remember buyandsell.gc.ca for those of you who are interested in accessing what we buy as a government and the potential that you have to be part of that procurement process. And in that program, by the way, this year we have $30 million. That's going to be $40 million next year. So take advantage of it, and as soon as your innovation is ready to be tested, all you need to do is get in touch with us through the buyandsell.gc.ca. Now, it's good to be here with my colleague, Steve Crocker, Minister of Fisheries locally, because Steve and I, we've been working very hard through small craft harbors to make sure that there's sufficient money available federally that we can spread out among small craft harbors in Newfoundland and Labrador. And we were so happy to make that announcement in Baie des Verts. And this is why when I found out who the recipients of the awards are today, that I was really pleased to see that Pat Quinlan is among the recipients, because in the processor category. We all know what happened in Baie des Verts with the burning of the fish plant. And we have put a significant amount of money back into Baie des Verts through small craft harbors, but it's in partnership with Quinlan Brothers. And it's a really good partnership where we're seeing an opportunity for the community to continue to exist and jobs continue to exist. So congratulations to Pat, and I'm sorry that he can't be here today, but congratulations to Fred Jackson and to Rufus Ginge as well. Again, it's really important, and I commend the show for recognizing the individuals and the caliber of those individuals and the contributions that they have made to the industry. So I look forward to being a part of that that ceremony later on. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Minister Foote. The buy and sell, I think there's a joke there somewhere. I just don't know what it is right now. Our second special guest this afternoon is the Honorable Steve Crocker. Mr. Crocker was first elected to the House of Assembly in 2014 by a by-election, and again in 2015 general election. In December 2015, Mr. Crocker was sworn in as Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture. In August 2016, Mr. Crocker's mandate was expanded to include forestry and agri-foods when the new Department of Fisheries, Forestry and Agri-Foods was created. That's a mouthful, isn't it? While in opposition, Minister Crocker served as critic for Business and Rural Development and the Research and Development Corporation. Prior to being elected, Minister Crocker served as executive assistant to then opposition leader Dwight Ball, and prior to that worked as an entrepreneur at his family's business. Minister Crocker resides in Hartford Lake, Islington, with his wife Nadine and their sons Benjamin and Alexander. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Steve Crocker, Minister of Fisheries, Forestry and Agri-Foods. Yeah.
Thank you, Carrie. And my intro is not quite as long as my colleagues. And 30 years of service, Minister Foote is pushing towards now, and to the people of Newfoundland and Labrador. And let me assure you, every single day, she works hard on behalf of the people of this province. And we've seen the results of this in the last 12 to 13 months. Again, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's certainly a pleasure to be here this afternoon and attend the North Atlantic Fish and Workboat Show. It's a great opportunity to see the latest technologies in the industry that support our marine industries in this province and make connections for you, the business people, that hopefully will form relationships going forward. Our renewable resources, such as seafood, have been the backbone of our economy in Newfoundland and Labrador for over 500 years. Today, more than 17,000 people in our province work directly in harvesting, processing, and aquaculture operations, and these industries generate benefits for many more. In 2015, the production value of seafood in our province was $1.2 billion. So that's a little bit about our industry. But more importantly, today we're here to induct three people into the Hall of Fame. And it's very important we recognize these people. In the mariner category, we have Mr. Rufus Ginge. He has a legendary like no other. His family has harvested the waters off the Northern Peninsula for over 200 years, and he has been active in the fishery himself for over 70 years. He has always been able to look to the future and adapt to changes in the fishing industry and upgrade his enterprise throughout the years. Mr. Ginge has passed along his expertise to his children and grandchildren, and his legacy will continue to play an important part in the seafood industry in our province. On the processing side, we have Mr. Pat Quinlan. Mr. Quinlan has been an institution as an owner, manager, president, and CEO of Quinlan Brothers Limited. He and his brother Morris changed the landscape of processing in our province. They were also able to adapt as the fishing industry changed throughout the year, years from processing cod to snow crab and shrimp. And in all likelihood, this company will be well prepared for a transition again back to groundfish. Whatever Mr. Quinlan has put his mind to, he has done. And that continues to this day. I will never forget the morning of April the 11th of 2016 with a plant fire in Bay de Verde. It was absolutely devastating, but true to the spirit, immediately Mr. Quinlan and his family started to make plans to rebuild that plant bigger and better than ever. And just in doing so, the company was able this year, and I want to give them some credit for the fact that they were able to accommodate their plant workers and limit some of the impacts on the region. In the boat building category, we have Mr. Fred Jackson of Whiteway. Mr. Jackson has been a boat builder since the 1970s. He also started out small, building a boat for himself to fish, and never looked back. He's grown his business from 3 employees at Jackson's Boatyard up to 42 employees at one point. And his son, Derek, continues that business today. As with Rufus and Pat, Fred also adapted and changed with the fishing industry. He has built wooden boats, then fiberglass over wood, and now fiberglass panels. Altogether, although no longer active in the boat building industry, Mr. Jackson still makes daily trips to the yard and definitely has made his impact on the industry. Thank you to all three of these remarkable gentlemen for their contribution to the industry. The common thread in all the success we've seen in these three individuals in the fishing industry has been to adapt and change with the industry. Now is no different. We are seeing a decline in shellfish and a return to a groundfish dominated industry. The provincial government recognizes this as well. We are taking steps toward preparing our seafood industry for a future that establishes seafood through establishment of a seafood innovation and transition program, which we announced in budget 2016 with funding of $2 million per year for the next 2 years. The seafood innovation and transition supports revitalization of the groundfish sector, innovation and technology, aquaculture and fisheries research, and development and strategic marketing initiatives. This year we have provided funding for approximately 36 projects which will see advancements in harvesting, processing, and aquaculture while addressing research and development opportunities. These initiatives will ensure that Newfoundland and Labrador seafood industry continues to be a major contributor to the provincial economy. By supporting innovation in the seafood industry, we have enhanced the industry's competitive edge for the world markets. There's definitely much to look forward to as we continue to support the advancements in our industry. Thank you again to the organizers of this Hall of Fame event and the organizers of this important industry show. And once again, congratulations to Rufus, Pat, and Fred on your induction into the Hall of Fame.
Thank you, Minister Crocker. I'll ask Minister Foote if she will join us on the stage as well. Now for the real reason why we're here today, the actual inductees of our nominees into the Hall of Fame. The first category is the Mariner category, and this year's winner is Rufus Genge. The Genge family's been harvesting the waters off Newfoundland's northern peninsula for more than 200 years. And Anchor Point fisherman Rufus Genge has been on the water for 70 of those. Rufus was born in Flowers Cove in 1937. His father and grandfather were fishermen. Fishing was in Rufus's blood. In fact, it was his grandfather's field in Cook's Harbor that Rufus started fishing full-time at the ripe old age of 10. The young Genge cut his teeth on the cod trap fishery, but always the entrepreneur, Rufus was anxious to start fishing on his own and acquired his first boat, a punt or a Rodney, and built his own stage at age 17. Shortly after marrying his lovely wife Sophia, Rufus continued to expand his fishing enterprise. He later moved from a trap skiff to a speedboat and would fish out of Cook's Harbor in June and July, and then would travel to Belle Isle and fish from there from August to October. He also fished out of Battle Harbor, Labrador for several years. But Rufus was always looking to the future and analyzing how he could grow as a fisherman and grow his fishing enterprise. This culminated in 1972 when he had the Cape Onion built, a 52-foot longliner, one of the first on the Northern Peninsula. Rufus's oldest son, Ted, who was fishing with his father at this time, said this was a major step forward. The new vessel allowed them to fish more species and for longer periods of time. But always the entrepreneur again, Rufus did not stop there. In 1977, he sold the Cape Onion and built the 65-foot Cape Ray to facilitate dragging. And then, in 1987, the elder Genge upgraded his enterprise yet again when he built another 65-foot dragger, the Tracy Martina. The fishing industry is constantly changing, and part of Rufus Genge's legacy was the foresight to recognize the changes, adapt to them, and succeed in a very challenging occupation. His legacy in the field of Newfoundland's Northern Peninsula also lives on through his family, his sons, Ted and Bruce, as well as his grandsons Rodney and Raymond, all operate successful, growing fishing enterprises of their own. Speaking of growth, Rufus was actively involved when the Gensch family built a state-of-the-art 65-foot fishing vessel, KMK Voyager, in 2006. And most recently, in 2016, this year, the elder Gensch witnessed the latest addition to the family fleet when the 70-foot KMK Voyager 1 slipped into the waters from the shipyard in Engelee. Rufus Gensch's fishing legacy is destined to live on for many, many years to come. And accepting the award on behalf of Mr. Gensch, who couldn't be here today, he's at home with his wife, who's ill, is his son, Ted. Ted?
Hard, but he couldn't be here on account of his wife's sake. But I'll see that he gets it, and I'm sure he'll be proud of it. Thank you.
The second category is the processor category. And this year's winner is Patrick Quinlan. Pat Quinlan was born in Redhead Cove in November 1929, the youngest of seven children in the family of Patrick and Alice Quinlan. Throughout Pat's life, he received many accolades and awards within the local community. However, Pat is not a person who seeks accolades. It is as owner, management, and president of CEO of Quinlan Brothers Limited that Pat leaves his mark on the fishing industry of Newfoundland and Labrador. Living next to the prolific fishing grounds of the North Atlantic, he and his brother Morris decided to stake their claims and bait a bird. In 1954, they bought J.F. O'Neill Limited, an enterprise consisting of a general store and the buying and selling of dried and salt bulk cod. Here, Quinlan Brothers began its 62 years in the seafood business. It was with the swing of a pickaxe at the walls of stone that surrounded them that Pat and Morris carved and etched out their first foundations of a small building to produce cod at Bay of Bird. The business grew from there, expanding into fresh and frozen fish production and then to marketing their products under the Q brand that is so well recognized today across Newfoundland, Labrador, as well as the world. Pat was the first to introduce and assist the local fishermen to move into larger longliners when he brought the first such vessel to Bay de Verde in 1964. Many more followed, and the product range expanded to include all the species harvested by inshore fishers. During the late 1960s and early 70s, the cod resource declined sharply, and Quinlan Brothers then entered into the snow crab business. The learning curve was steep, and before long, he and Morris had persevered to build a crab plant and market a crab product that was second to none. Following the collapse of the ground fish industry in the early 1990s, Quinlan's became the first to venture into the shrimp business on the northeast coast of the island by acquiring a plant from Denmark and establishing it at home. Quinlan Brothers Limited was buying and processing shrimp just as the resource was made available to the inshore fishery in 1997. Pat Quinlan does not know the meaning of "it can't be done." Negativity is nowhere in his character. He was always the most industrious and energetic person in the fishery. He knew everybody in the plant as well as every fisherman he spoke, and spoke to them always as equals. He respected their hard work and spent a lifetime reinvesting everything back into the fishery. Unfortunately, as we all know, a fire destroyed everything Pat built at Bay de Verde on April 11th, 2016. A fire took with it years of hard labor and a host of memories. But true to who he is, a new modern plant is well on its way to replacing it all. It is a monument to Pat and those who have worked with him. Bay de Verde will always have a special place in the heart of the most industrious person ever in the history of the Newfoundland fishery. And accepting the award on behalf of Mr. Quinlan is Kim.
And yes, Pat does still come to the office on a regular basis. So my apologies and regrets from the family that they're unable to be here today to celebrate this. I know it meant a lot to Pat and to the family. Pat still makes his rounds. He'll go over to the south side to check on the boats, what boats are out, what boats are in, who's catching what. He'll drive up on Signal Hill to see who's out on the water, and he makes a run two or three times a week down to Bay de Verde and Old Perlican to check on the plant, what's going on, and to say hi to the people and everyone in the office. So I don't think anyone who's spent any time with Pat, it doesn't take long to recognize the passion and commitment that he's put into the fishery over the years. It's part of what he is and who he does. And I think it's been well said already what that has meant to processing and fishery in the small community. Last week we were having a lunch to celebrate his birthday, and we head into the office. So Pat's favorite food is always on takeout. He always gets the codfish. We can eat out three times a week, and Pat will have cod three times a week. So someone around the table said, "Pat boy, you must have eaten a lot of cod over the years in your lifetime." And Pat looked at him and he said, "Yes, and it still tastes just as good." So just thank you very much for this honor. It's very much appreciated by the family. And we're hoping that the Navigator and anyone else, media, if you'd like to come to the office to get a picture of Pat with his award over the next couple of weeks, that would be really appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you. The final category this afternoon is the Builder category, and this year's winner is Frederick Jackson. Frederick Jackson was born on January 25th, 1937, in the small community of White Way, Trinity Bay. Now, my father was a Pezentia Bay schooner captain, and he always, I grew up being told it was White Way. So I don't know which is White, White Way people, White Way. Anyway, I had to take that up. Yeah. Mr. Jackson is husband to Beulah Cooper and a proud father of five children. Frederick, or Fred, is now known as White Way's boat builder. See, White Way, see? Boat builder but things didn't start that way. From railway tracks to mink ranching and fishing, Fred did it all, and it carried him through the 1950s, 1960s. In 1971, he took a new journey and built a boat for himself to fish, a 52-foot small inshore dragger. In September of 1976, Fred sold that boat and built another for himself on his own. In his backyard, Fred built a 3411 wooden boat and only used her one summer on the water. Once again, he sold that boat and decided to pursue a different career as a full-time boat builder. With a demand in the area for fishermen wanting new boats, Fred thought, why not give it a try? With the second boat built in his backyard, he then moved to the current Jackson's Boat location in 1978. Jackson's Boatyard started with three employees and quickly went up to six. As the years went on, Jackson's Boatyard staff grew with as many as 42 employees working at one point. Jackson's Boatyard specializes in wooden to fiberglass fishing vessels. From 1977 to the early 1990s, wooden boats were built, then wooden boats fiberglassed over. In 2001, fiberglass panels were used to build vessels. Jackson's Boatyard symbols can be found on many boats around the island of Newfoundland, as well as the Labrador coast, ranging from 28 to 65 feet in length. While Fred has not been an active boat builder since 2006, now just shy of turning 79 years old, he still makes daily trips to the yard to watch and inspect the ongoing boat construction. Mr. Jackson could be here this afternoon, so accepting his award will be his son, Derek. Induction part of the ceremony. I would encourage everyone to stay around, enjoy some cake and coffee.